Take us back to where it all started. You and I were raised in almost similar villages where the only instruments we had was a mingling stick and a saucepan or some metallic something.
Yeah.
Stella Tush is our guest, the only female saxophone player that we have in Rwanda. An experience shared is a life saved or a life improved. Join me every week as I sit with incredible people willing to share their joys and struggles and incidences that propelled them from one point to the next. We will also hear of events that turned lives around. My story, your story, our life.
At what stage
in your life did you get to interact with such a sophisticated instrument?
That was about 4 years ago. So I was in a friend's car, and his ringtone had this beautiful song.
Uh-huh.
And the song started with an intro of a saxophone. And I didn't know, of course, what it was.
Yeah, I was going to ask, how did you know it was a saxophone?
No, I didn't know. It just sounded so beautiful. Like, even right now, that song is so beautiful to me.
Yeah.
So I just asked a friend of mine who was more traveled than I was, and she said she thinks it's a saxophone.
Mm-hmm.
And then I asked her, do you think I can learn it?
Yeah.
So she said, yeah, of course you can do it. So I started now thinking of how to get a saxophone.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I got to learn about the sax. And then I would Google a few things, see how the sax looks like, because I didn't even know how it looked like. And then I read that the alto sax is the easiest to learn with.
Mm-hmm.
So I requested for an alto sax, and luckily I got it towards the end of 2014.
Yeah.
That's when I got it.
Okay. By that time, had you learned how to play it?
No.
Had you touched it before? Like, before you ordered yours, did you, say, walk into a shop that sells instruments to have a look at it, touch it, feel it?
No. First of all, we don't even have them on sale here in Rwanda.
Okay.
So there was really no exposure to one.
Wow. How long did it take you to learn?
I can't say I'm there yet. You know, but to get comfortable in the first place took a while.
Feels like every time you're playing, I feel a lot of pain. It feels like it's sucking air out of you, out of your lungs.
No.
Is the feeling anywhere close to that?
In the beginning, yes, it was very tough. The first time, even bringing out the sound was so hard. I learned one thing: if you really want to do something, and then you'll be able to do it.
Yeah.
But I also believe that if you love something, you will work at it until you're able to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So then tell me about the first time you played for people in public. Was it your family? Was it in school? Like if you had a free performance somewhere before it started paying, because now I know it does pay, and we'll get to that part.
Yeah. So for the very, very first time, I had two friends who were getting married, Betty and Ivan, and I asked them, so you guys, can I play sax on your wedding? They're like, you play sax? And they're like, yeah, actually, but I'm still very, very shy about it.
Yeah.
So I was like, I could play you this song, the wedding song I had the very, very, very first time.
Yeah.
It's called The One He Kept For Me by Moret Clark Brown.
Mm.
So I sent them this song and told them, by the way, I could play this on your wedding as you walk in. It will be beautiful. What do you think? And they were so excited.
Wow.
You know, and they're like, yeah, oh my God, that's amazing. And they trusted me with their wedding. Someone recorded something very brief, and it sounded really good. And I was like, whoa, is that me?
You loved it.
Yeah, I loved it. Mm. And I couldn't believe it was me. And I couldn't believe I pulled it off, you know, before so many people. Oh. So that was the beginning.
So then were there other weddings you performed at?
Well, after that, let's see, it was a very tough season, by the way. Because now I was like, okay, so now that I've stepped up, maybe I should be involved in other places, find a band, maybe play at church, you know, now that I've stepped out. But it wasn't easy. There was so much rejection coming in.
Yeah.
No one trusted you. They'll be like, yeah, you played on the wedding, but definitely not in the main service or something, you know.
I can't believe that.
Oh, yeah.
I think that people should have been excited. This is something new. It's not like the guitar that everyone in church plays.
Yeah. Ooh. It doesn't instead work the honoring, like that. Yeah. But I guess, you know, think you are? Sometimes it's God trying to remind you that, yo, you know that special? Yeah. Chill.
Yeah. As a Christian, you'd interpret it that way.
Yes, but it was hard. I wouldn't say it wasn't hard. It was very hard. Mm. And so it took me back to my room where I had been playing for about a full year. Yeah. So I went back to my room, rehearsed, played my favorite songs. You know, I'll just play to, I guess, my sister who I lived with and my neighbors. Yeah, after the New Times wrote about me.
Yeah.
It was around October, I think. Mm. Around September. So Remy calls me the following month and is like, yo, can you come and play something at the Jazz Junction? And I was like, okay. I was scared. Yeah. But it's good to have friends that encourage you. Because my friends literally pushed me to go perform there, and I got to perform with Isaiah, you know.
Oh, yes.
So yeah. After the Jazz Junction, that's when now the work began. So after that, that's when I started like playing at different bands, weddings, being invited. But all this was mostly free.
Okay.
It was paid in exposure. Yeah.
Like for a lot of artists.
Yes, like for a lot of artists.
Mm, yeah.
And then one day my sister tells me, you know what, you can actually find a coffee shop, a small place where you can play regularly.
Regularly, yeah.
Your friends will show up to see you. People like your music. I said, okay, I can try that. So that's how I ended up at Portofino.
Mm-hmm.
Villa Portofino in Nyarutarama. Those guys, yo, they trusted me. And they're like, of course you can come play. And they were excited about it. And I formed a small team.
Mm.
And yeah, it was...
I remember you had a band.
I had a band, yeah. It was amazing.
Yeah.
It went beyond my expectations.
Yes.
And I didn't turn back from that. So it's been work after work after work.
Yeah.
And
what would you say, where do you see yourself and the saxophone industry in Rwanda in the next few years?
So I'm really trying to find ways of impacting the next young generation using music. So I want to make it wider than saxophone, because not everyone will be interested in learning a saxophone. But instead I want to get these little kids to discover their gifts early enough, you know, if they're interested in sax or drums or poem, or you know, something that will give them the confidence to be future leaders, because music gives you so much confidence.
It does. Okay, as we conclude, other than the saxophone, what else do you do with yourself?
Do communications for the African Institute for Mathematical Sciences.
Ooh.
And I've been there for about a year plus, and I like it.
Great.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming by, Stella.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much for watching Evolve. We'll see you again next week. As we keep saying, the stories will keep coming. Bless you.